We are towards the end of our second theme, which is the theme of equations in one variable, and we have seen several methods to find the roots of such equations. So what we want to do this time is to compare those methods but from a different point of view. In the last slide of the previous lecture, we compared bisection method with the other methods, but today what we would want to do is to compare how quickly they converge to the intended root. So we need to introduce a term, we need to formalize what it means by converging it to the given root fast enough. So we will do that once we have introduced this new term, and then we will compare these methods. So this is typically called the order of convergence. You might have several sequences going to a single point, converging to a single point, and they might converge with different speeds. For instance, 1 upon n will converge to 0, 1 upon n square will converge to 0, and 1 upon n power n will also converge to 0. But it's clear that 1 upon n power n will converge to 0 much more quicker than the previous two terms. So these are the things that we would like to compare, and that is why we want to conceptualize it, and we make this definition of the order of convergence. So suppose we have a sequence Pn which converges to the point P, and assume that Pn is not equal to P for any n. This is something that we are going to assume because we will have to divide by Pn minus P at some point. Now if you have positive constants, so these lambda and alpha are needed to be positive. If you have these positive constants satisfying that limit of mod Pn plus 1 minus P upon mod Pn minus P power alpha equal to lambda. If you have this, then we say that the order of convergence of Pn to P is alpha, and the asymptotic error is lambda. This is what we say. So for instance, what it tells you is that the Pn plus 1 minus P is lambda times Pn minus P power alpha. And remember, alpha is positive. And what we are actually going to get then is that Pn is close enough to P compared to the alpha power of Pn, the distance of Pn from P multiplied by lambda. So this is what we have. We will see some examples, so don't get confused by these terms. When we have an iterative technique which gives you that Pn is g Pn plus 1, then we will have this sequence Pn converging to the fixed point. If that sequence converges with some order alpha, then we say that our iterative technique gives you a convergence of order alpha, or the order of the iterative technique is alpha. This is what we are going to say. Okay. So in general, whenever you have a higher degree of convergence, it means that your sequence is converging more rapidly than a sequence with lower order. Okay. And the asymptotic constant will really not make much of a change, but it will only change the speed of the convergence. I must also point this out to you that whenever alpha is 1, if your this alpha is 1, you are going to take limit of the Pn plus 1 minus P under modulus upon Pn minus P. But if Pns are going to P, ultimately the distance should become smaller, and therefore this ratio should become less than 1. That is what we should have. So whenever alpha is 1, it is clear that for the convergent sequences, lambda is going to be less than 1. Although this is not going to be mentioned, perhaps we will mention it only once, but this is implicit, and this is not required for higher orders, because higher orders, this asymptotic constant will not change the order. Ultimately, for smaller numbers, the higher enough powers will become much smaller than 1 upon lambda for any positive constant lambda. Okay. So there are two cases of order which are most important for us. There is the linear order where alpha is 1 and then lambda is going to be less than 1, and the quadratic order. So when alpha is 1, and of course we understand that lambda is going to be then less than 1, the sequence is called linearly convergent. Okay, and for alpha equal to 2, we say that the sequence is quadratically convergent. So these are the two cases, and we are now going to compare some simple examples of these sequences, one of them being linearly convergent, another being quadratically convergent. So let's see how we compare these two orders of convergence, linear vis-a-vis quadratic. So suppose Pn is a sequence which is going to 0 with linear order of convergence, and the asymptotic error is 0.5. We will always keep the same error for both of them. And Qn is going to 0 with the quadratic order of convergence. Okay, so for Pn the order is linear, and for Qn the order is quadratic. The asymptotic constants are same. Alpha is 1 for Pn, alpha is 2 for Qn. So what we get is this, that limit n going to infinity mod Pn upon mod p, mod p n plus 1 upon mod Pn is 0.5. And for Qs, what we get is limit n going to infinity mod Qn upon mod Qn square is 0.5. So this is the small change, and we will now see how these terms behave. So first of all, for Pn, roughly Pn is 0.5 times mod of Pn minus 1. Right, that's the approximate value of mod Pn, and this mod Pn minus 1 is again roughly half of mod Pn minus 2. So our mod Pn is 0.5 square into mod Pn minus 2. And if you expand it, if you do it all the way till P naught, what you get is that roughly mod Pn is 0.5 power n into mod P naught. So this sounds something like our bisection method, where at each step, the next one is closer to the root by a factor of 2. And now we go to Qn, and you will see that there is a rapid change. What we have is that Qn from this part of the second part in the things which is put in the center. So what we have is that mod Qn is 0.5 mod Qn minus 1 square. Okay, approximately, because Qn upon mod Qn minus 1 square is 0.5 as the limit n goes to infinity. So you have that approximately mod Qn is mod of Qn minus 1 square upon 2, 0.5 into mod Qn minus 1 square. But mod Qn minus 1 itself is 0.5 into mod Qn minus 2 whole square. And this term is going to be in the bracket. So this mod Qn minus 1 is approximated by this blue quantity, which is mod of Qn minus 2 whole square upon 2. And then there is a square sign out already outside. So what you get, the power of 0.5 outside is 3. And the power of Qn minus 2, that is 4. That will not change. And then this next level will give you two powers. The power of 0.5 is added by 2, and the power of the next term, the previous term Qn minus 3, is also taken as the square, and so on until we reach the Q naught term, and you see that it's 0.5 power 2 power n minus 1 into mod Q naught power 2 power n. So the mod of Q naught, that is also becoming square at each time. Earlier you had mod Qn, then mod of Qn minus 1 square, mod of Qn minus 2 power 4, Qn minus 3 power 8, and ultimately mod Q naught power 2 power n. So supposing our initial approximations P naught and Q naught, if they were the same, then where do we reach after the nth step? We see it here. So this is the approximate value of mod Pn in terms of mod P naught and mod Qn in terms of mod Q naught. If you put mod P naught equal to Q naught equal to 1, these are both sequences which are going to 0. Okay, but we have P naught equal to Q naught equal to 1, then this is what we get. So the earlier, this is the Pn. The first column is for Pn, where you have 0.5, 0.25, 0.15, and so on. And then 0.065, 625, and so on. So we reach 10 power minus 3 at the seventh step. Whereas if you were looking at the quadratically convergent sequence, you, at after the seventh step, you have reached 10 power minus 39, which is quite a lot. So Qn is within 10 power minus 38 because there is something else outside multiplied to 10 power minus 39. So suppose we put that also inside point and get something here, it will be 10 power minus 38. So it is within 10 power minus 38 of 0 by the seventh term already. It's the typically what we will say is that if you are giving something to us closer to the result by 5 digit or by 10 digit, we will be fine. And for our quadratically convergent sequence, the 10 digits are already achieved by the fifth stage. Or let's say if there are 9 digits, at the next step, you are going to get 18 digits. So the number of correct digits that you are getting, that is almost getting double. Okay. So this, you are going to get it as 10 power minus 38 by the seventh term. And if you wanted to do it by the linear convergence, you would need at least 126 terms. So we see that the quadratically convergent sequences are going to the limit point very, very fast. Okay, so we should try to get quadratically convergent sequences. They are really the best. And now what we are going to do is that once we have understood this business of order of convergence, we should find out what is the order of convergence of the fixed point iteration method. That is something that we should try to find out. So suppose I have a function from AB to AB, which is differentiable. And because it's from AB to AB, there has to be a fixed point. And if the modulus of the derivative is less than or equal to k, which is further less than 1, then the fixed point is unique. And we also assume that f prime is continuous. Then define this fixed point iteration, which is you take any p naught and then take p n plus 1 to be f of p n. Now these above conditions that we have, they will ensure that you get a convergent sequence. You get p n, which is going to go to the fixed point. Okay, and we want to compute the order of convergence. So consider this p n plus 1 minus p. But p n plus 1 is f of p n, and p is also f of p because p is the fixed point. So our middle term is f of p n minus f of p. Now, the function being differentiable will give you by mean value theorem that this is equal to p n minus p into the derivative value at some xi n. That's the mean value theorem, where this xi n is some point between Pn and P. What this xi n is, that is not known to us yet, but it's some point which is between Pn and P. And Pn, of course, converges to the point P. Therefore, we will have that xi n will also converge to P. So if we have to take Pn plus 1 minus P and divide by that Pn by P here, the limit is f of f prime xi n, limit of that f prime xi n, and that is going to be mod of f prime p. So if your mod of f prime p or f prime p is not 0, then you have here alpha equal to 1, the power of the denominator pn minus p, and your lambda, non-zero lambda. Remember, it is important that those constants alpha and lambda are positive. They should be positive. They are not allowed to be zero. So here this mod f prime p, if this is non-zero, then we get a linear convergent sequence. So what we have obtained is that our sequence not just goes to p, but it goes to p with a linear order of convergence. So as bad, maybe if we can say, as the bisection method. It cannot do worse than bisection method. Okay. But if you were looking for even better order of convergence, then you should have that this fixed point problem, you know, we are converting from the root finding problem to the fixed point problem. And root finding problem has a unique function. We want to find a root of that function. But how you convert it into a fixed point problem is up to us. Largely, it is up to us. So the function that we are going to get out of it to convert the root finding problem to the fixed point problem is not a unique function. You can perhaps get a better function whose derivative at p is zero. And then you will get a higher degree of convergence. That is what will possibly happen. So if you want to get, whenever your f prime p is non-zero, you get linear order of convergence. So if you want to get higher order of convergence, it is necessary that this f prime p should be zero. But perhaps, who knows, if f prime p is zero, even then we might get only linear order of convergence. Or is there a result which will say that whenever f prime p is zero, we get a higher order of convergence? Luckily for us, there is a theorem. This is the theorem. So suppose we start with this fixed point problem, which has a solution p. Assume that the derivative is zero. And now whenever you have a condition on some function, we have to have that particular function be differentiable, and then there should be some more properties. That is something which is, you know, almost like a norm. So here we will assume that f double prime not just exists, but it is continuous. And its modulus is less than m nearby p. That means there is some interval near the point p where mod of f double prime x is bounded above by some quantity. We don't now require that it be less than 1. Some quantity, capital N. Okay, so it is bounded function. Then there is a delta positive such that for any p naught between p minus delta and p plus delta, the sequence of iteration given by the function f converges at least quadratically to p. So whenever you have the derivative of the fixed point function to be non-zero, the sequence will converge linearly. And this theorem says that whenever the derivative is zero at p, you get at least quadratic convergence. You might even get a higher order convergence, who knows? But at least quadratic is guaranteed, and that's good enough for us. Because by seventh stage, you have been close to, you got correct, 38 digits are correct. So that's a big deal for us. So we are happy with quadratic order of convergence. And moreover, whenever you have a sufficiently large value of n, it will also tell you how this constant, the asymptotic error, is related to m by 2. Okay, so let's, armed with this result, let's try to find a sequence which is quadratically convergent. All we have to ensure is that the derivative is zero at p. Okay, that's the thing. We start with the root finding problem, convert it into a fixed point problem with the added property that the fixed point problem has the corresponding function derivative should be zero at p. This is what we want. Okay. Now let's see which method we are going to get. So we are looking for, we will search for functions whose derivatives are zero at the fixed point. Okay, so fp is p, f prime p is zero. This is what we want. And we are doing all this for root finding problem of some function g. Okay, so how do you construct a fixed point problem from this? Because whenever there is the corresponding function for fixed point problem, its fixed point should give you a root of your problem, the original root finding problem. So the easiest way perhaps is to define fx equal to x minus some function phi x into gx. And we will also make sure that this function phi is non-zero at p. So that whenever the function f is zero at p, you are going to, whenever the function f has p as the fixed point, you will get that phi p into gp is 0, but phi is non-zero at p, and therefore gp has to be 0. So a fixed point for f will be a zero for g, and a zero for g is clearly a fixed point for f. Okay, so this is how we are now going to find this function phi with the property that the derivative of our f at p should be zero. And phi is going to be a differentiable function which we will choose later. So now the derivative of the function f, it's a simple formula to obtain the derivative of product of two functions. So you have 1, because that's the derivative of x, minus p prime x gx minus px g prime x. Okay. Now at the point p, we want to say that f prime is 0. Okay, so we will put p in this equation. What happens to phi prime p? That we don't know. What happens to gp? So gp is 0. Because p, the fixed point for f, is the root for g. Okay, so gp is 0. Therefore, when you put the value x equal to p here, you get 1, and then you get the last term, which is phi x g prime x. And then you have to take the difference of these two. So what you get is that 0 equal to f prime p is 1 minus phi p g prime p. Or it says that phi p is 1 upon g prime p. So at the point p, we want to find this function phi. But it has the property that at p, it should look like 1 upon g prime. So why don't you just take phi equal to 1 upon g prime throughout? So we are going to rewrite this function equation now with phi equal to 1 upon g prime. So what we get is pn plus 1, which is f of pn, is actually pn minus gpn upon g prime pn. And I believe that you all would have recognized this as our good old Newton-Raphson method. But there is one small point here that we wanted to have this phi p defined, and so g prime p has to be non-zero. What is the function g? So there are many functions and their derivatives at p are either zero or non-zero. So let's try to understand all these things. That we have the root finding problem and we have a function for that. If that derivative is non-zero, then you can define the corresponding Newton-Raphson fixed point iteration way to get the quadratically convergent fixed point method. Okay, so for fixed point method, the function should have derivative zero at the fixed point, but the root finding problem function, that should not have derivative zero, because you will have to divide by that g prime. Okay, so that is a small problem here, and it's actually not really a very small problem. It's a very tricky problem. Because if your g prime p is 0, Newton-Raphson method will not work, and typically the second method will also not work. So we will have to see what we do, what we need to do if this g prime p, if the point p, which is the 0 for the root finding function g, if that has the property that p is not just the 0 of g, but it's also the 0 of the derivative, then there is a problem. So this is something which is related to the multiplicity of a zero. So let's just, this is something that I believe you would have done in your calculus course. So let's just recall it very quickly. We have a function g from a, b to r, and there is a zero of that function which we call by p. Okay. We say that this p is a zero of multiplicity m of the function g, if you can write gx as x minus p power m into qx, with the property that as x goes closer to p, qx is not zero. So in some sense, q is the function which has nothing to do with the zero property of g at p. You know, if your g was a polynomial and if you had p as the zero of this polynomial, then we know that x minus p has to divide this polynomial gx. If some more powers of that x minus p divide gx, then you will have the derivative, you will have the division. And then finally, there will be a division qx such that you have gx equal to x minus p power m into qx, and q is not 0 anymore at p. So all the contribution of the point p being 0 is now taken out. And that contribution is called the multiplicity of the point p as a 0 of the function g. Okay, so if you were to look at the Taylor series approximation, you will see that it starts from x minus p power m. The Taylor series approximation for q will start from a constant term, right? And then it will go on to higher powers. So the Taylor series approximation for g will start from x minus p power m. This is what, you know, typically happens. So whenever g has a simple 0 at p, which would mean that g is 0 at p, but g prime is not 0 at p, or to say in other words, this m is equal to 1. Therefore, once you have taken x minus p out, you can actually write it down. If m is 1, gx is x minus p into qx. So g prime is x minus p derivative, which is the constant term, into q, plus q prime into x minus p. And then when you put the value of p back, that q prime into x minus p will give you 0. But q is not 0 at p, and the x minus p ka derivative has become a constant term. So the derivative of g at p is non-zero. So having the derivative of g at p being non-zero is ultimately related to the point p being a simple 0 of the function g. Okay, so the Newton-Raphson method will work well for such functions. And we will see an example now to see that Newton-Raphson method will actually not give a quadratic convergence if this order of 0 is more than 1. So we see that there are two kinds of if and only if statements. We earlier saw that for the fixed point problem, if the derivative is non-zero, we get linear order of convergence. But if the derivative is 0, we get quadratic or more order of convergence. And now we see by an example, of course, so it's not quite an if and only if statement, but it says that when the point P is the 0 of G of higher order, even Newton-Raphson method will not work. And the reason for that is this example. Suppose we take this example, e power x minus 1. Now we know that e power x is like 1 plus x plus x square by 2 factorial dot dot dot. And you are removing that 1 and x. So immediately you should see that 0 is the point 0 is the 0 of this function g with multiplicity 2. Okay. You can also see it by computing derivatives. So g prime is e power x minus 1. G double prime is simply e power x. And when you put the value x equal to 0, g of 0 is 0. G prime of 0 is also 0. So it's no more a simple 0, but it's a 0 of order at least 2. And the further 0, g double prime 0 is 1, which is not 0. So the order of the 0, the point 0 being a 0 of g is equal to 2. Okay. So x is therefore a 0 of g with multiplicity 2. And we will apply Newton-Raphson method. We will want to check how it goes. We will take the initial approximation to be 1. And we will approach the point 0. Using Newton-Raphson, so this is what we get. P1 is P0 minus G P0 upon G prime P0, which is roughly 0.58, and P2 is roughly 0.31906. So here we have computed the first 16 iterations, and we see that while this sequence is definitely converging to 0, but it's not going to 0 quadratically. Why is it not going to 0 quadratically? That you can see, because whenever you take the next term, take its square and divide by that to the previous term, you get a sequence which is going to infinity. Because forget about P0 and P1, let's say, but if you are taking P2 upon P3 square, then you see that P3 square is 0.16, and that is like the square of 0.16, or let's say it is 0.17 if you round it up. That will give you 0.0289. And 0.0289, you are dividing by that. So that is roughly like multiplying by something which is almost like multiplying by 30. and you are multiplying by 32.31. So that is giving you the quantity to be 9. And if you do the same thing as P3 upon P4 square, then you see that you get something which is bigger than 9. In fact, if you look at some of the later terms, P15 upon P16 square, you see that you have gone much more beyond some powers of 10. So PN plus 1 upon PN square, that does not have a limit. It is not a convergent thing. So therefore, what it tells you is that while this is converging to 0, it's not a quadratic convergence. Is it a linear convergence? That's something that we will have to check. Or maybe the convergence will be between somewhere between 1 and 2. But it's definitely not a quadratic convergence. So here is the problem. We have a Newton-Raphson method which has been working so well. But for the simple problem that our root finding function, the original function whose root we wanted to find, has the property that the root is a quadratic root. And therefore, we cannot apply the Newton-Raphson method. Can we improve upon that method? Does it even look possible that something that Newton has devised and Raphson modified it in a small way, but has been such a good method, can we improve it further? You bet, we mathematicians are good at improving things. So we will see this in our next lecture, which is likely to be last lecture in this theme. So we will continue with our series for some more weeks. Thank you for staying with me and see you in the next.